Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents When Animals Dream, The Hidden World of Animal Consciousness, by David M. Pena-Guzman, narrated by Charlie Thurston. Publisher's note: this audiobook will refer to visual elements included in the print and ebook editions of the book. Introduction. In the trenches of sleep. I can hear little clicks inside my dream. Night drips its silver tap down the back. At 4 a.m., I wake, thinking. Anne Carson. Heidi's Dream. Season 38, Episode 1 of the PBS series Nature, Octopus Making Contact, promised viewers a rare journey into the inner lives of octopuses, billed as the closest we may get to meeting an alien. The star of the one-hour documentary is Heidi, a female day octopus, Octopus cyanea, who lives with the narrator David Scheel, a biologist at Alaska Pacific University. Unlike most captive octopuses, Heidi lives neither in an aquarium nor in a laboratory, but in Scheel's private residence in Anchorage. A charming mix of roommate, companion animal, and research assistant. Octopus Making Contact tells a tale of octopuses not as stupid creatures, which is how the Greek philosopher Aristotle described them in 355 BCE, but as intelligent and naturally curious beings who have unique personalities, recognize others of the same species, and solve complex problems. From start to finish, octopuses are presented as conscious agents who know when they are being observed and who, more importantly, do not hesitate to observe in return. "When you look at them," says Scheel, "you feel like they're looking back. That's not an illusion. They are looking back." Near the end of the documentary, as Heidi is shown sleeping in her tank, Scheel reports, "Last night I witnessed something I've never seen recorded before." What follows is a breathtaking one-minute-long shot. In it, Heidi is at first peacefully restful, but after a few seconds her skin lights up, displaying a sequence of dramatic multicolored patterns, each one more mesmerizing than the last. The something Scheel is referring to may be an octopus dream. His voice then walks the viewer through each of Heidi's arresting displays, noting you could almost just narrate the body changes and narrate the dream. Display 1. Heidi changes from a smooth and constant alabaster white to a flashing yellow with blotches of mandarin orange. So here she's asleep. She sees a crab, and her color starts to change a little bit. Display 2. From these splendid shades of yellow and orange, Heidi changes to a dark and piercing purple. A purple so deep that for a fraction of a second, we cannot tell where her body ends and the dark blue background begins. Octopuses will do that when they leave the bottom, usually after a successful kill, Scheel explains. Display 3. Heidi then changes into a series of light grays and yellows. Except this time the colors are crisscrossed by a disordered topology of ridges and spiky horns, the textured byproduct of the contractions of the papillae on her skin. This is a camouflage, like she's just subdued a crab and she's going to sit there and eat it, and she doesn't want anyone to notice her. The camera then turns to Scheel himself, who says with noticeable elation, "This really is fascinating. If she's dreaming, that's the dream." Heidi became a viral sensation overnight. Within days, thousands of people shared the video of her dream on social media, and major news outlets rushed to cover the story. Viewers were simultaneously fascinated and stupefied. Her sleep displays were stunning, a veritable kaleidoscope of flesh. But what did they mean? And beneath this procession of color and texture, what was Heidi herself thinking or feeling? As Elizabeth Preston put it in the New York Times, "An octopus is almost nothing like a person. So how much can anyone really say with accuracy about what Heidi was doing?" Pan out, and the bigger question becomes, What goes on in the minds of non-human animals when they sleep? Or, as the poet Anne Carson says, when night drips its silver tap? Do they experience those penetrating nightly visions that humans do, which Shakespeare described as the children of an idle brain? Or do their minds simply plummet into a psychic void in which no conscious experience takes root? Can other animals, not just octopuses, but parrots, lizards, elephants, owls, zebras, fish, marmosets, dogs, and so on, truly dream? If so, what does this tell us about who these creatures are and how they dwell in this world? And if not, does this mean that dreaming may be the cognitive Rubicon that separates us from the other animals? Are humans the dreaming animal, as the Spanish philosopher George Santayana believed? This book is about these questions. Animal interiority. Even though humans have been fascinated by the possible dream worlds of other animals for millennia, the first modern scientific publication devoted to animal dreaming appeared in 2020. In an article published in the Journal of Comparative Neurology under the title "Do All Mammals Dream?", the biologists Paul Manger and Jerome Siegel expressed doubt that only humans experience dream sequences during sleep. And they wonder whether dreaming, that curious mental happening that the sociologist Eugene Halton describes as the mind's nightly ritual of inner icons, may be a universal feature of mammalian life, something we share with all other species whose young feed from the mother's mammary glands. I will come back to this mammal-centric hypothesis in Chapter 1. But for now, I want to emphasize that this article stands out within the field of animal sleep research as a genuine anomaly, the only publication in a scientific journal to use the terms dream and dreaming explicitly in connection to animals other than Homo sapiens. To be clear, this is not the only publication to shed light on what goes on inside the minds and bodies of animals during sleep. Far from it. Over the last century, biologists, psychologists, and neuroscientists have made significant strides in cracking the code of animal sleep, giving us a fuller picture of the imperatives of animal experience across the great sleep-wake divide. Nevertheless, these same experts have historically shied away from describing their findings using the language of dreams. Instead, they have opted for more phenomenologically ambivalent terms, such as oniric behavior and mental replay, that allow them to talk at great length about the mechanics of animal sleep, the biological processes that regulate it, the physiological changes that prompt it, the neurochemical changes it occasions, and so on, without needing to take a stance on whether any of the animals under study actually experience anything subjectively at any point during the cycle of sleep. Because of their intrinsic agnosticism, these terms end up blotting out some of the most philosophically stimulating questions raised by the possibility of animal dreaming, especially questions concerning consciousness, intentionality, and subjectivity. In this book, I build on contemporary animal sleep research to show that what scientists refer to as oniric behaviors and mental replay in sleeping animals should be interpreted as the result of internally generated dream sequences that animals experience, even if only momentarily, as their very reality. Rejecting this phenomenological interpretation, I argue, would require holding two conflicting beliefs at once. First, that many animals display the same patterns of motor and neural activity during sleep that are widely accepted as indices of dreaming in humans. And second, that while this bustle is going on inside them, these same animals sense, feel, and think nothing. It would almost require believing that the minds of animals magically disappear into the ether the moment animals drift off into sleep. That, immediately upon entering the kingdom of hypnos, a gaping abyss opens up beneath them and swallows them whole. While this position is not necessarily illogical, a close reading of the empirical data reveals it to be untenable. Even if scientists are reluctant to talk about the dreams of animals, say for reasons of scientific humility, their findings point in precisely that direction. My concern is that aside from betraying a problematic double standard, this reluctance to talk about animal dreaming feeds a larger cultural prejudice that rationalizes our appalling treatment of animals. In a seminal article on animal consciousness, the father of cognitive ethology, Donald Griffin, called this prejudice mentophobia, the fear of viewing animals as creatures with minds of their own. This fear leads us to see animals as food to be consumed, reservoirs of labor power to be exploited, resources to be used, and specimens to be cultured and dissected, as anything that is except creatures who live, feel, and think on their own terms. While mentophobia affects all areas of social life, Griffin recognized that it exerts an exceptionally strong pressure on the scientific community, a pressure that is most conspicuously on display whenever scientists resist attributing complex mental states to the animals they study, even when there is ample support for it. It is because of mentophobia that most of us continue to see animals, in the now infamous words of the philosopher Norman Malcolm, as thoughtless brutes, that is, as creatures who eat, sleep, and die, but who never develop a meaningful cognitive, emotional, or existential bond with the world. Once animals are pigeonholed into this category, their fate is sealed. There are simply too many things one cannot expect from a thoughtless brute. One of them is the capacity to dream. And yet, watching the displays of Alaska's most famous cephalopod feels very much like witnessing the collision of two subjective realities, one human, one not. It is almost as if Heidi's flamboyant metamorphoses bring within the reach of our human, all too human senses, that alluring yet inscrutable realm of reality from which every human observer has been barred from time immemorial, the inner world of another animal. Perhaps a phenomenology of animal dreaming can explain why. If, while watching Heidi's displays, we feel that we are coming face to face with another subjective reality that is recognizable and alien at once, this may be because the band of colors marching rhythmically on the surface of her skin bespeaks a dream. A dream that, much like the dreams of the myriad other animals we will encounter throughout this book, is itself an irrefutable sign that there exist, alongside ours, endless other worlds, utterly other inhuman worlds, enigmatic, foreign, hidden animal worlds. Worlds without human contours, worlds with non-human centers. An integrative approach. There are experts that worry that attributing dreams to animals anthropomorphizes them by projecting a uniquely human ability onto them. In their view, animal researchers should stick to what the philosopher of science Peter Winch calls external descriptions of behavior, leaving considerations of animal interiority to their colleagues from across the quad, the philosophers. In defense of this division of intellectual labor, they offer a host of arguments. Sometimes they invoke the authority of Morgan's canon, which says we must opt for the simplest possible explanation of animal behavior. Sometimes they appeal to the philosophical problem of other minds, which maintains that we cannot say that animals have an interior life because we lack direct access to their first-person experience of the world. At other times, however, they hint at the problem of language. In the absence of a shared language, they say, we cannot make empirically meaningful claims about how, when, or why, or even whether, other animals dream, let alone about the nature, structure, and quality of their putative dream experiences. What are dreams, after all, if not unobservable mental happenings, whose existence we can infer only on the basis of subjective verbal reports? Reports that animals cannot provide. However appealing, this view relies on the conceit that the scientific study of dreams depends solely or mostly on the compilation, analysis, and interpretation of dream reports. Surely dream scientists have learned and continue to learn a great deal from the verbal reports of human dreamers about what our minds and bodies do when we go offline. But the bulk of dream research since the 1980s has not been exclusively or even primarily based on the analysis of linguistic reports. It has been based on the investigation of the neural and behavioral correlates of dream experiences, which is to say, the brain activity and bodily behaviors that correspond with the subjective experience of dreaming. A brief survey of contemporary human dream research reveals a vast, interdisciplinary, and rapidly evolving field in which experts concentrate on spotting the neural signatures, e.g. pontogeniculo-occipital, or PGO waves, and behavioral markers, e.g. rapid eye movements or REMs, of human dream phenomenology. While our inability to speak with other animals certainly limits what we can know about their dream experiences, it does not prevent us from making meaningful and empirically educated claims about their capacity to dream, or even from ruminating about the possible implications of this capacity for ongoing scholarly debates about animal consciousness, animal emotion, and animal ethics. Indeed, throughout this book, I use an integrative method to advance several such claims. In essence, this method involves 1. Surveying the empirical literature on animal sleep for findings that might point to dream experiences in other animals, and 2. Interpreting these findings through a philosophical lens that combines conceptual tools and resources from such fields as phenomenology, the philosophy of consciousness, and the philosophy of animal cognition. Using this method, I can take the empirical data seriously while asking vital philosophical questions about what this data means. For, as we shall see, its meaning is up for grabs. The book, Structure and Aims. People who interact with animals as part of their everyday life, animal lovers, farmers, veterinarians, animal activists, and so on, may be tickled by the thought that someone would write an entire book about something that strikes them as obvious, that we share the ability to dream with many other critters. But holding this belief is one thing. Defending it on scientific grounds is another. And teasing apart its philosophical implications is yet another. In the chapters that follow, I do all three. In Chapter 1, The Science of Animal Dreams, I turn to animal sleep research to catalog evidence that animals run reality simulations during key phases of their sleep cycles. Even taking certain methodological and conceptual limitations into account, the preponderance of this evidence supports the conclusion that humans are not the only dreamers on Earth. In Chapter 2, Animal Dreams and Consciousness, I consider the philosophical significance of the evidence laid out in Chapter 1. Here, I introduce the SAM model of consciousness, which distinguishes three types of self-awareness. S for subjective, being at the center of a phenomenal field of experience. A for affective, experiencing events as emotionally shaded. And M for metaconscious, having the ability to reflect upon one's own mental life. Guided by phenomenological theories of dreaming, I assert that all animals who dream are necessarily subjectively conscious, that most, if not all, are also affectively conscious, and that a select few may be metaconscious as well. In Chapter 3, A Zoology of the Imagination, I take the discussion of animal consciousness to a higher level by accentuating the imaginative character of dreams. Given that dreams hinge on the generation of sensory, visual, tactile, auditory, and so on imagery, creatures who dream must possess what the philosopher of mind, Jonathan Ichikawa, calls imaginative capacities, such as creativity, fantasy, and make-believe. I explore how these capacities congeal in dreams, while presenting dreams as part of a larger spectrum of imagination that includes inter alia, hallucinations, daydreams, and mind wanderings. In Chapter 4, The Value of Animal Consciousness, I tackle the ethical dimension. Do the dreams of animals matter from an ethical standpoint? Under most ethical frameworks, the answer to this would be yes, as consciousness is thought to determine which entities have moral status and which do not. Here, I use the philosopher Ned Block's famous theory of consciousness as a jumping-off point for articulating a novel account of why dreams are pregnant with what I call moral force. On this account, dreams are morally significant because they reveal animals to be both carriers and sources of moral value, which is to say, beings who matter and for whom things matter. The book closes with a short epilogue, Animal Subjects, World Builders, in which I offer some final thoughts about the subjectivity of other animals and about what binds us and cleaves us from them. It is in this tension between sameness and difference, between conjunction and disjunction, that the heart of this book lies. If inhabited correctly, I argue, this tension can open up contemporary debates about animal minds and animal experience, and make us question some of our more disturbing assumptions about our non-human comrades, so that we can begin the task of collectively learning to see animals truly anew. No longer as the evolutionarily, cognitively, metaphysically, or even spiritually impoverished versions of us that we have historically taken them to be, but as the fully realized, inviolable, sacred versions of themselves that they already are and always have been. Chapter 1. The Science of Animal Dreams. As dogs, cats, horses, and probably all the higher animals, even birds, have vivid dreams, we must admit that they possess some power of imagination. Charles Darwin. The Silent Century. Scientific debates about animal dreams date back at least to the late 19th century. In the wake of the publication of Charles Darwin's On the Origin of Species and the Descent of Man, proponents of the rising evolutionary framework began circulating the idea that animals share many of the mental capacities previously assumed to be solely human, including the capacity to dream. One of the earliest proponents of this idea was the Scottish physician William Lauder Lindsay, who offered a spirited defense of it in his 1879 book Mind in the Lower Animals and Health and Disease. Citing classical and contemporary reports of dreaming animals, Lindsay held that dreaming is not the sole province of Homo sapiens. In a chapter entitled Dreams and Delusions, he has the following to say about what happens in the minds of dogs when they fall asleep. As regards the dog, and especially sporting dogs such as the harrier, the following facts have been noted, or the following inferences drawn. It appears to hunt in its dreams, as was long ago remarked by Seneca and Lucretius. During sleep, movements of the tail and paws, sniffing, growling, barking, occur. There is every reason to believe that there is frequently during sleep in the sporting dog an imaginary pursuit of imaginary game. That this supposed pursuit gives rise to actual physical and mental excitement, including, for instance, eagerness and panting for breath caused immediately thereby, and that this excitement sometimes causes the animal to awake. And this is not limited to one or two breeds. He continues, just as hounds of harriers chase in their dreams imaginary game, collies or other dogs worry in their sleep imaginary enemies, or snap, presumably, at imaginary flies or other insect tormentors. In other words, in their sleep or dreams, they appear to engage in imaginary quarrels, games, pursuits, and attacks. The chapter goes on to describe dream states in animals as varied as horses, birds, and cats, and offers an elegant analysis of the relationship between dreams, delusions, and hallucinations. Dreams, for Lindsay, are powerful indications that animals have complex minds. Belief in animal dreams was widespread at the height of the Victorian era. The anti-vivisection movement was gaining steam in Europe and North America, and public attitudes about the status of animals were changing rapidly. In this climate, the conditions were ripe for increased interest in the mental and emotional lives of animals. Among the scientists of the time, this interest expressed itself as a general openness to a wide variety of claims, some more empirically grounded than others, about animal experience, including claims about what happens to animals when they sleep. This belief was so widespread that Darwin's protege, the evolutionary biologist George Remains, cited Lindsay's theory of animal dreams enthusiastically in his 1883 masterpiece, Mental Evolution in Animals. In this book, which was read with gusto by audiences on both sides of the Atlantic, Remains went further than Lindsay in asserting that dreaming proves that animals are endowed with the faculty that the German moralist Immanuel Kant had categorically denied them only 100 years earlier, the faculty of imagination. Dreaming proves that animals have what Remains dubs imagination in the third degree, which enables animals to form mental images independently of any obvious suggestions from without. In Remains's view, the same mental operations are needed to dream of something as to visually imagine it, since in both cases the mind directs itself towards something absent and relates to it as if it were present. Dreaming, he concludes, constitutes certain proof of imagination belonging to the third degree. In holding this view, the biologist from Kingston, Ontario, was not challenging the spirit of his time. He was channeling it. In 1888, only 5 years after the publication of Mental Evolution in Animals, the popular magazine The Century ran an article about the science of dreams, nightmares, and somnambulism that included a section on animal dreams. Among the experts mentioned as defenders of an interspecies theory of dreams were lesser-known figures such as William Lindsay and George Remains, as well as such luminaries as Charles Darwin. A year later, the Canadian biologist Wesley Mills published his seminal Textbook of Animal Physiology, which included a lengthy discussion of the dreams of animals, especially dogs. That same year, the French psychologist Alfred Binet, inventor of IQ testing, reviewed several books on dreaming in the journal The Psychological Year, L'Année Psychologique, including the Italian psychologist Sante de Sanctis's book, Dreams, Psychological and Clinical Studies, I Sogni, Studi Psicologici e Clinici, which devoted an entire chapter to interviews de Sanctis conducted with breeders, farmers, hunters, and circus trainers about the dreams of superior animals such as dogs, horses, and birds. Animal dreams may have been deeply ingrained in the cultural and scientific imaginaries of the 19th century, but the tide eventually turned. Due to several developments, especially the rise of behaviorist psychology, which began in the 1870s, as a wave of support for the complexity of animals' minds morphed over the span of only a few decades into a pervasive skepticism about animal cognition of any kind. After the turn of the century, the life sciences adopted a new attitude, a colder, more distant attitude, that led new generations of scientists to distance themselves from their predecessors and to accuse them of projecting human abilities onto animals. By the 1930s, many of the topics that had galvanized 19th century naturalists, animal reasoning, animal language, animal emotions, animal play, and of course, animal dreaming, had fallen into scientific ill repute, and most of them remained there for a long time. I call the period stretching from the 1900s to the 1980s the Silent Century, because during this time, discussions of animal consciousness came to a standstill from which our scientific culture is now trying to break free. Thankfully, scientists from various fields have started reclaiming some of these topics as legitimate objects of scientific inquiry. Since the 1990s, research on animal emotions has exploded, as has empirical and philosophical work on animal cognition. Unfortunately, the topic of animal dreaming has not been so lucky. As of the time of this book's publication, almost 150 years after the publication of Lindsay's Mind and Lower Animals, the bulk of the scientific community continues to dismiss the idea that animals dream, let alone that their dreams might be empirically studied, as anthropomorphic, which is to say, as a romantic and non-scientific illusion that misleads us into projecting the traits of the human onto the non-human. This is true of many scientists who specialize in dreams, but it is almost universal among experts in animal sleep. The irony is that over the last three decades, the life sciences have generated a good deal of evidence that our 19th century forebears may have been right about what the minds of animals do, in the words of Jennifer Doom Pair, at the edges of sleep. In this chapter, I catalog and analyze this evidence, dividing it into three categories: electrophysiological, behavioral, and neuroanatomical. When properly interpreted, this evidence shows that our collective error was not that we considered humans and the other animals on a continuum of mental activity during the 19th century, but rather that we turned our backs on this continuous perspective in the 20th, and as a result, our perception of animals changed for the worse. We began seeing their lives as so deficient, so dull, so bare, and so contemptible in comparison to ours, that in an act of collective self-delusion, we convinced ourselves that they could not possibly have what we have, a meaningful inner world. That was our mistake. Electrophysiological evidence, from zebra finches to zebrafish. A soundless song. In the year 2000, the biologists Amish Dave and Daniel Margoliosh published a report in the journal Science describing their research on zebra finches, Tiniopidia guttata, which are passerine birds native to Australia. One of the evolutionary challenges these birds face is they must learn their song from their parents and siblings, since it is not innate. Research on birdsong has historically focused on what these animals do while awake to imitate and memorize their song. But Dave and Margoliosh wondered whether sleep might also play a role in song.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.